write them on the tablet. The vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me will forever be fruitful indeed. I am the way, the truth, and the light. No one gets to the Father except that He comes through me. Yeah. So let not mirth, and truth, say forsake you. Let not mirth, and truth, say
just for being in the presence of the Lord this morning. We are excited, delighted, and elated to have you join us this morning. Can you look to your neighbor and tell them good morning? Give them a good God bless you. And thank you for being in the service this morning. We give God honor and reverence this morning just for being in the service one more time and being able to enjoy his presence on this beautiful Palm Sunday. Isn't it a beautiful morning this morning? Yes. So we will have you join us in our praise and worship this morning. The song says, God is great and greatly to be praised. Don't we serve a great God this morning? Don't we serve a great God? The greatness of the Lord.
The greatness of the Lord is inconceivable. The love that he shows is unconditional. The power of the Lord is unbeatable. Great is the God we serve. The greatness of the Lord is inconceivable. The love that he shows is unconditional. The power of the Lord is unbeatable. Great is the God we serve. God is great and greatly to be praised. God is great and greatly to be praised. Of the Lord is inconceivable. The love that he shows is unconditional. The power of the Lord is unbeatable. Great is the God we serve. God is great and greatly to be praised. God is great
come on, if you serve a blessed God in this praise. Come on, keep those hands clapping. God is great, and he's greatly to be praised. Come on, Redeemer Love, God is great, and he's greatly to be praised. God is great, and he's greatly to be praised. From the rising of the sun to the going down of the very same, his name is worthy to be praised. For this is the day that the Lord has made. And I don't know about you, but on this Palm Sunday, I come to give God praise. Not for what he's doing in my life, but how he keeps blessing me in my life. How he keeps food on the table. How he keeps clothes on my back. How he keeps me in my right mind. I come to open up my mouth. Give God praise. Give God praise. Give God praise. Because he's entering into the city. He's entering into this holy week. He's entering into this place. Because this is the day that the Lord has made. And on this Palm Sunday, I come to remember. I come to reflect. And I come to give God praise for what he's about to do in a week's time. I come to give God praise for how he's about to come rescue us in a week's time. I come to give God praise for he's about to shake the earth. He's about to shake the earth. He's about to shake the earth and come save us from our own selves. So I don't know about you, but I come to give God a thank you praise. His name is worthy. His name is worthy. His name is worthy. His name is worthy to be praised. 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 When I can't think of nothing else, all I can do is think of the goodness of Jesus. And all that he's done. Because my soul cries, hallelujah. I thank God. I said, I thank God for saving me. He saved me from my own self. He delivered me from the hands of the enemy. If I couldn't say a word, I'd just wave my head. Because when I think about how he brought me through, how I think about how he's bringing me through, how I think about it, I just get light on my feet. Because when I think, I got to praise. I got to praise. I got to praise. Hallelujah. Sorry, I didn't come up here for all that. But when I think about how God is snatching us out of some things, how I think about how he saved us from our own selves, just kind of gonna give God praise. We serve a forgiving God. We serve a faithful God. We serve a true and living saving God. And that's enough to give God praise. My God, my God. Clap your hands all over the room. Hallelujah. Thank you. We will now have scripture and prayer by Deacon Emery Dodd.
Good morning. With everyone still standing this morning, I'll be reading to your hearing Isaiah 43, verses 15 through 19. And it reads, I am the Lord, your Holy One, the Creator of Israel, your King. Thus saith the Lord, which maketh a way in the sea and a path in the mighty waters, which bring forth the chariots and horse, the army and the power. They shall lie down together. They shall not rise. They are extinct. They are quenched as tow. Remember ye not the former things, neither consider the things of old. Behold, I will do a new thing. Now it shall spring forth. Shall ye know it? No, shall ye not know it? I will even make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. I have read into your hearing Isaiah 43, 15 through 19. Let us go to God in prayer. Our Father and our God, as we come on this Sunday morning, God, we thank you. For God, we realize without you, where would we be? And as we stand in the sanctuary on this morning, oh God, we first come to say, forgive us. Anything that we have done that is not pleasing in your sight, oh God, forgive us now and create within us a new and a right spirit. And as we stand together on this Sunday morning, God, look into the future, realizing that just a few days from now, that we celebrate that you are a risen King. How you hung on a cross at Calvary's Hill for our transgressions, for our sins. But you rose on a Sunday morning with all power in your hand. And oh God, we invite your presence in this place right now. Come sup with us just a little while. God, this is your house. Have your way, oh God. We invoke your presence here right now. God, we thank you for just being God and God alone. And oh God, on this Sunday morning, in this place we call redeeming love, God, let the Spirit flow from heart to heart and from breast to breast, oh God. God, we ask now that you bless the man's servant who will come and bring forth the word on this day, God. Gird him up on each and every side, God. Let him proclaim your word with boldness and in truth, that it may touch somebody's heart, that they say, what must I do to be saved? And oh God, as we stand in this place right now, whatever we stand in need of, oh God, I ask that you will grant it one by one, name by name, oh God. God, bless these, your people. God, we owe it all to you, because without you hanging on a cross, where would we be? God, we thank you and we love you. It is in the name of Jesus we all pray. Let us say amen.
Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. We would like to welcome you to the campus of Redeeming Love. If you're joining us online, let us know where you're from. And we will now have a selection by our praise team, followed by announcements from our pastoral aid committee and pastoral remarks from my pastor, Reverend Dr. Mark T. Gibson. Amen. Amen.
Redeeming Love Classic. I just want to praise you because he's so good and so deserving. I just
just wanna praise you forever and ever and ever. Blessings and glory and honor, they all belong to you. Thank you, Jesus, for blessing me. I just wanna pray.
Is this on? Does this work? Hello? Should I grab one of them? They're gonna sing one more.
Is busy, but God is still good. Hallelujah. Come on. Glory and honor is due him. Say, come on.
Glory and honor is due him.
Glory and honor is due him. Say,
glory.
Yeah.
glory.
It's through your name.
All the glory.
I said, all the glory.
All the glory.
Say, all the glory.
All the glory.
When I don't feel like it,
all the glory.
I'm gonna bless your name.
All the glory.
You get all of the glory.
All the glory.
You get all of the honor.
All the glory.
When I was in my sick bed,
all the glory.
You healed me.
All the glory.
So I give you the glory.
All the glory.
I give you the glory.
All the glory.
Hey, all 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 the glory.
All the glory.
All Christ.
All the glory.
It's on the rock I stand.
All the glory.
All of the ground.
All the glory.
They sink in sin.
All the glory.
Hey, all the glory.
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 All the glory.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If he's been good to you, give him a praise this morning. If he's been good to you, clap your hands. Say something to him. All the glory. All the glory. Could have been another way, but I give him glory. Could have been another way, but I bless his name. I bless his name. Oh, come on. You act like God hasn't brought you through something. Come on and give him a praise. Hallelujah. Say, oh. Your name, God. All the glory belongs to him. Hallelujah. Hey.
Good morning and hallelujah, redeeming love. How are y'all doing today? Y'all know y'all only see me a few times up here. I've been advised I have to be good. I want to say, Tonto, let's ride. I want to say, I'm peacock proud. But I'm not going to do that today, because today is all about love. I'm here to talk to y'all about what it means to be in love, what it means to be in love to people married for 15 years. Hallelujah. Can I get a hallelujah over there? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I am here, for those of you who don't know, my name is Monique Long, and I'm here to represent the Pastor's Aid Committee. And I normally give the pastor and first lady a hard time, but today I want to represent the church to say happy anniversary. The pastor and first lady have been married for 15 years. I'm going to quote from 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 4 through 8. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no records of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always preserves. Love never fails. There are multiple references in the Bible that mention the word love. Love means different things to different people. Love is the one thing, if you read about it, that people say they search their entire lives to feel what their version of true love is. I had a conversation with the First Lady when I first moved to Singapore, and she said, I don't know how you do it. I can't be away from Mark 24 hours. I was shocked by that, because I, you know, I lived in Singapore. My husband lived here. We love you, boo. We make this work. You know, I can't be still. And then I was at a card game one time with the pastor. And if you have never been at a card game with the pastor and the first lady, there's this one word you hear him say over and over again, and it's go. He'll go, go, give me some what? Go, what you doing? Go. And I just go, Lord, I hate that name. I know she hate it. And it, and that day, it had got on my nerves, but I won that game. And because of you being a bad card player, I wasn't really that offended. But it says the love that you have for each other. It reminds me of what it means to be in yoke with someone. And so on this day, we want to recognize you. And we have a video that we have prepared. Wow, like, come on now. Trying to say, on behalf of the PAC, the pastor stood up here last year and said he was taking First Lady to Italy. And if we leave that up to you, she might never make it. So I wanted to help with that, the PAC decided. So what we're presenting to you is a travel certificate. You have a travel certificate. We've arranged a travel agent. This certificate entitles you to 7 days and 6 nights in accommodations, along with breakfast and guided tours. Airfare is not included. And it has a set value, for the record. But we want to say thank you. Thank you for all you do. We need y'all to take a vacation. And so on behalf of the PAC, yes. Yes, we are very serious.
Oh my God.
I have one more thing. We plan to give you these every special year, but we have a beautiful plaque to commemorate your 15 years of marriage and love. Thanks. Very proud of you. Thank you. You're welcome.
Wow. Did she say Italy? Oh my God. Thank you all so very much. We are, we're celebrating 15 years and 15 years of wedded bliss, and all you married people know it's not easy, but it's all worth it in the end because love never fails.
Let me, first of all, good morning.
So good to see all of you, and so good to have you here. And since airline fares that, we're going to walk up the King's Highway.
We will get there.
We will get there. Trains, planes, and automobiles, however it's going to happen. Let me thank you all from the depths of my heart. This truly is a show of love for us, but we even have more love for you. It is an absolute privilege and an honor for us to be the pastor and first lady of this church, but more importantly, to be on the assignment that God has for us. And so 15 years of her putting up with me, and me putting up with her, amen. But I wanna thank all of you. I wanna thank our PAC. I thank you from the depths of our heart. And as this morning's message will tell you, the best is yet to come, amen. All right. Amen. Happy anniversary to you, Lady Margo, and if I had to do it all over again, I'd do it. Sister Linda, you got me? You got me? I can state it? Oh, you're talking about how many years you're. I'm talking about, can I stay at your house today? Okay, gotcha. Ain't nothing changed. Ain't nothing changed. She's not only a great wife, she is a great friend. And I am so blessed to have her by my side. Amen. Amen. Don't you wink at lady like that no more. Don't do it. Don't do it. I want to say to each of you that the Lord is blessing tremendously, not just in this church, but in your lives. And if you need proof of it, let me grab a mirror for you to look into, and you can determine that the Lord is blessing you. I wrote a post the other day, and I want you to keep this in mind, that your bitter cup is unavoidable, but your better cup is inevitable. Listen to what I just said. You will have to drink from a bitter cup in life. Things will not always go your way. But if you just hang on and hold to God's unchanging hand, your better cup is on the way. Amen. I wish I had a few folk that, you know, you didn't just pity pat that. You just know that your bitter will turn to better. Listen, next Sunday, there is no sunrise service here, but there will be Sunday school at 9 a.m., and then our morning worship for Resurrection Sunday begins at 10. In the midst of our Resurrection Sunday worship, we will have the play, The Cross, written by our very own minister in training, Janice Hawkins. If you would stand, Janice, so folk can see you. Amen. You will see what a wonderful production that will be on next Sunday. We will have Children's Church and also, like I said, Sunday School, Children's Church, and Morning Worship. We are in our final week of our fast. Amen. Look, some of y'all can't wait for midnight on Saturday night. Y'all be turning into Bojangles sitting there early in the morning. Tell the truth and shame the devil. You done had grilled chicken, baked chicken, chicken cordon. No, you can't have cordon bleu, but anyway, you've had chicken and fish all kinds of ways this past couple of weeks, but it's been good for your body. Let's tell the truth. It's really been good for your body, and if I don't eat another piece of fruit, I'm going to be all right. I promise you I'm going to be all right. So we're asking you to continue to even after the fast, I want you to continue to pray for marriages and families, singles and couples, children and young adults. I want you to pray for the vision and the leadership of this church, the fellowship and the unity of this church. Also, we're praying for spirituality, mental health, strength, and also for finances. When we pray all those things and keep those in prayer, God makes us stronger together. Amen? And so we're thankful for you. Listen, on this coming Wednesday night, we will have Word on Wednesday via Zoom and also Facebook. And then on Thursday is Morning Manna Prayer with our very own Reverend Rhonda Simpkins, who does an awesome job with us every single Thursday morning and Thursday at 12 noon. On Friday, March the 29th, it is our last seven statements from the cross. Seven of our ministers will be preaching on that particular night. You see them there, Minister Wanda Stroud, Reverend Rhonda Simpkins, Minister in Training Chris Phillips, also Minister in Training Adrian Keller, Minister in Training Bryant Miller, also Minister in Training Janice Hawkins, and Reverend Denise Dobbin will be preaching on this coming Friday. It is Holy Week, and I want you to remember that this is the week in which he leads us back to the cross and also redeems us back to the Father. The annual Easter egg hunt is on Saturday at 1 p.m. Let me tell you, I've talked to the meteorologist, big weather, and we're going to have some great weather this weekend. So please bring those babies out at 1 o'clock on Saturday for the Easter egg hunt. And don't forget, once again, the play, The Cross, will be done during our morning worship. Somebody say spring revival. Okay, y'all kind of whispered it, but I want to hear the church say spring revival. We have the Reverend Dr. Marcus D. Cosby from the Wheeler Avenue Baptist Church in Houston, Texas. Do we have a clip of my man's and them? Come on, let's play this clip so you know who's coming.
The Bible says that the just shall live by their faith. The Bible says we walk by faith and not by sight. The Bible says that without faith, it's impossible to please the Lord. And is there anybody in here on a Sunday morning who feels like pleasing the Lord? You want to honor him in everything that you do? Well, get some word in you and know that the Bible says weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. The Bible says that my God shall supply all my need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. The Bible says that my God is able to keep me from falling and present me faultless before his glory with exceeding great joy. The Bible says no weapon, hey, formed against me shall be able to prosper. The Bible says I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. The Bible says I'm the head and not the tail. I'm above and not beneath. I'm the lender, not the borrower. So somebody get this book, open it up, and begin to testify. I shall overcome. I shall make it through. This too shall pass. God will make a way. God will open doors. God will fight my battle, because he's faithful to 1,000 generations. Won't he make a way for you? Won't he open doors for you? Won't he provide for you? Say yes, 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 oh yes.
Dr. Marcus D. Cosby, who will be here in Raleigh, North Carolina, the 15th, 16th, and 17th. You owe it to yourself to be with us. those 3 nights of heaven on earth. And so we look forward to an awesome time. Spread the word to your friends, your co-workers, your neighbors, your family members, so that we can be here. Also, I am going to ask those of you that can come to St. Matthew's Baptist Church, 5410 Lewisburg Road in Raleigh, for their Alzheimer's and Related Dementia Community Summit. We have partnered with St. Matthew's to help co-sponsor this, and we're asking members of our congregation to please support this on Saturday, April the 27th from 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. And we'd like for you to register and see Sister Wanda Stroud or Minister Rhonda Stroud, if you would stand, for you to sign up. And if you can help with serving in hospitality, they would love to have you. Amen. Are there any visitors here with us on this morning? Any visitors here with us? Please stand. All visitors. God bless you. Thank you. God bless you. Good to see you again, my friend. Thank you all so much for being here with us. Would you remain standing? Our usher, our chief usher, our chief usher is coming to you right now to provide you with some cards for you to fill out. And if you would, just fill those out and drop those into the plate as it comes around, and we would be most appreciative. We want to stay in contact with you. But I want you to know from all of us, the leadership team, our First Lady, and all the partners of this church, how much we appreciate you worshiping with us on today. Redeeming Love, would you, those of you around them, would you just share some redeeming love with them and thank them for being here with us on today? Amen. Come on, come on. Let's do that. Let's thank God for our visitors. Those of you online, we appreciate you. Amen. 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 Come on, show them some redeeming love. Amen. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Listen, I am excited to see Brother Sterling Quash here with us. I know why you're here, Doc. I know why you're here. I need the wolf pack to keep winning so he can keep coming to church. Come on, let's thank God for the wolf pack. Amen. Representing North Carolina. Amen. Yeah, and that other team too. Whatever. It's speaking of Wolfpack, it's good to see Trent Penix here with us on today. God bless you, man. Good to see you. Amen. We're going to bless the Lord in our giving. And what time is it? What time is it? Okay, that's cute. It's giving time. No, really, seriously. What time is it? 10:51. We'll be out by 11:30, I promise you. We'll be out by 11:30. Amen. Giving is an essential part of our worship. And the reason it's so essential is because he showed us this coming week what it was to give. He gave his only son. And look at the benefits that we have as a result of his giving. Can you imagine if we could sacrifice just a portion of what he already did? Imagine how blessed we would be. Matter of fact, just imagine how blessed you are right now. God has richly blessed all of us. And so on this morning, I want you to remember the Lord in your tithe and also in your offering. Because giving is a part of our worship and our service unto him. It is David who writes, I beseech you, or Paul writes, I beseech you, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present or give your bodies as a living sacrifice. And so there's 5 ways to give here at Redeeming Love. The first way is Givelify. That's the app on your tablet or on your phone. If you don't have it, you can download it. The other way that you can give is Cash App, $RLoveRaleigh. When you give that way, we look forward to you being a blessing to us. The third way is text the word GIVE to 919-364-5500. The fourth way that you can give is mail it to our secure post office box, P.O. Box 46044, Raleigh, North Carolina 27620. And the final way is there's an envelope in the back of your pew. If you want to fill that out, or if you just want to give the cash, it's totally up to you. But we're going to ask you if you would utilize that envelope. And if you're here in the sanctuary, whether you're giving electronically or through an envelope, we ask that you would raise your offering as we prepare to give back to God a portion of that which He has blessed us with. And so with your gifts raised, I want you to repeat our giving statement. And it simply says this: give, and it shall be given unto you. In good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. Shall men give unto your bosom, for with the same measure that you meet withal, it shall be measured to you again. Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we bless you and we honor you on today. God, we thank you for this opportunity to give back to you a portion of that which you have given unto us. Now, God, bless the gift and the giver. It's in the marvelous, matchless, and majestic name of the Master we do pray. It's in Jesus' name, and all of God's people say amen. All right, we're going to ask our trustees if you will come through. Please keep your envelopes or your gift that you have in your hand. Please keep those raised so they can see where you are and they can come and retrieve it in the basket. Listen, it is so good to see Deacon Angelo Payton here with us on this morning. God bless you. Come on. Come on. Earlier this week, he was in the hospital, but look what the Lord has done. He's brought him back to the house of the Lord. God bless you, sir. Good to see you. We're continuing to pray for you as well. Mother Bishop, good to see you here today as well. We thank God for your good report. And it's going to get even better. Amen. Those of you that have been sick and shut in, we are praying for you and continuing to pray for you as you recover and recoup. Listen, join me in the book of 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians, the second chapter, verse number 9. We're going to try to get through this one this morning. Amen. 1 Corinthians, second chapter, verse number 9. Amen. Let's welcome our worship and praise team back as they come to bless us with the sermonic selection.
So that means even at our lowest, at our highest, we give God our best when we say hallelujah. Amen? Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. My hallelujah belongs to you. 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 You deserve it. You deserve it. You deserve it. You deserve it. My hallelujah.
My hallelujah. It belongs to you.
Come on, if you know it this morning, sing with us. My hallelujah.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
Oh, my hallelujah.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
Say, my hallelujah.
My hallelujah belongs to
hallelujah.
You.
Hallelujah. All over the building. Say, you deserve it.
You deserve it.
You deserve it.
You deserve it.
Say, you deserve it. When my money's looking funny, my hallelujah belongs to you. When I got sickness in my body, my hallelujah belongs to you. I want to hear y'all say, come on, say my hallelujah. Come on, if he's done something for you, say my hallelujah. Come on, just when you think back, my hallelujah, when I think of the goodness of Jesus and all he's done, my hallelujah. And when we have nothing else to say, we say this, oh, 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 oh. Oh, can we give God a hold this morning to say, oh, hallelujah. Oh, 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 we're gonna end it right here. Oh, oh, come on and bless your Savior. Hallelujah. He's so good. Hallelujah. My hallelujah belongs to Him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Turn to somebody and say, my hallelujah belongs to Him. Turn to somebody else and say, my hallelujah belongs to Him. Hallelujah. Come on and bless the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
He deserves it. Come on, tell somebody he deserves it. My hallelujah belongs to him. Amen. Father, in Jesus' name, we've come to bless you. God, we thank you for the scripture. We thank you for the prayer. We thank you for our presider navigated us to this point in worship. The songs of Zion have blessed your holy and righteous name. Now, God, we need an impartation from you on this day. As you rode triumphantly into Jerusalem, God, let us ride this week triumphantly with your word that promises never to leave us nor forsake us. God, thank you for the Holy Ghost that comforts and sustains us in times like these. God, these are praying times when our government can't seem to be on one accord. But you declared in your word that the government shall be upon your shoulders. God, we're trusting you that what man and woman can't do on Capitol Hill, it was already accomplished on a hill called Calvary. God, now bless your word on today. Penalize not your people for the frailty of this your priest. Hide me behind the cross. Speak to me and through me. And now may the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart, God, allow it to be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. It is in the marvelous, matchless, and majestic name of the Master we do pray. It's in Jesus' name. And all of God's people shouted, amen. Shout amen again. 1 Corinthians, the 2nd chapter, verse number 9. But as it is written, eye hath not seen, nor ear heard, neither have it entered into the heart of man the things which God hath prepared for them that love him. Can you say amen? You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. This is my final installment of this series I've been preaching and teaching in called I Series. The letter I and slash E-Y-E, I series. And for this morning's message, just as it was supposed to be last week, I want to preach from the subject, the best is yet to come. Yeah. I guess y'all got it all out last week, so let me try it for the new people that came. The best is yet to come. If you believe that, you'll shout it out real quickly. The best is yet to come. I know what I see right now, but the best is still yet to come. I know what it looks like right now, but the best is yet to come. And if you believe it without even having to see it, you can shout out amen right now. Amen. Amen. Aristotle, the Greek philosopher, said that the windows of our soul can be seen through sight, smell, hearing, taste, and touch. Those five senses that we have. Smelling. Some of us can smell something in it. We reminisce back to even when our grandmother would fix certain meals. You would smell it and you could go back. Smell a certain scent and think of a certain person. Hearing, when you hear certain things, it also reminds you of yesteryear, and it triggers something in your mind when you hear certain songs, or you hear a certain voice, or you hear someone that's talking and it reminds you of someone. Tasting. Oh my goodness, that tastes just like grandma's sweet potato pie. Or you could taste somebody's banana pudding and it would put you in a flashback mode. Some of us can remember certain touches that when you were in pain, your mom had a way of just touching you, and it made everything all right. Isn't it something that the father teaches the son how to play football and play basketball, and as soon as they win the championship, he gets in the camera and says, "Hi, Mom." But here it is. There's a touch that only can soothe you like nobody else. The old folks used to say it like this: "He touched me, and all the joy that floods my soul." Something just by a touch. You do remember in the Bible that when the woman touched the hem of his garment, the Bible says what was flowing for 13 years automatically stopped. When Jesus touched the eyes of the blind man, the Bible says that he was able to see. Jesus touched the casket. The dead boy came back to life. Something about a touch. Many of us remember back in the day. I don't need to talk to you. Always had a gold star on your head. I'm talking about folk that had to go to detention all the time. All somebody had to do was touch you the wrong way. They're going to catch those hands, or we're going to move some furniture. I know y'all save, sanctify. I want to talk to the real folk this morning. You touch me the wrong way, it could cause all kinds of havoc. But then there is the fifth sense. That's seeing. You see certain things, and because you've seen certain things, it can both encourage you or discourage you. When you see somebody who worked their way from the bottom to the top, that's an encouragement. But when you see somebody who's supposed to be a representative of what is good, it can discourage you. All you have to do is watch the news here lately. It can be a discouragement by what you see. Somebody who claims to be a billionaire, now all of a sudden he broke. Y'all ain't got to talk back to me. You mean to tell me you ride around in a 747 with a Rolls Royce engine on it and you broke? You asking me to help you with your legal fees. Okay, all right. Here it is, ladies and gentlemen. Sometimes what we see can affect who we are. But I've come by to let you know that Paul writes here to the church of Corinth that it is written that I haven't seen, ear hasn't heard, neither has it entered into your heart the things, the great things that God is about to do for those, watch this, who love him. This ain't for everybody. This is just for folks who love him. And if you love him, you won't leave him in times of difficulty. Come on, let me talk to the couples right now. Some of you realize that you've had more trauma and drama in your marriage that could have easily given you a hall pass to walk away, but you stayed right there because there was something called love. My brothers and sisters, here Paul is writing to the church at Corinth, and he's writing to encourage them in a wicked place. Paul is encouraging their faith to be in God's power and not human wisdom. Many times we try to rely on our own wisdom without relying on God. I don't care how many degrees you may have. I don't care how many schools you've attended. I don't care how much experience you have under your belt. If you do not have God, you are nothing. Let me say it again. I don't care who you are. I don't care where you graduated from. If you do not have God, you are nothing. Because you can do all things, not through your intellect, not through your knowledge, not through your degrees, but it's through God that we can do it. Solomon wrote in Proverbs 3:5, he says, trust in the Lord with all thine heart. Lean not to your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and what? He shall direct your path. And I don't know about you, but I've walked off the path several different times. But when I've acknowledged that God is my light and my salvation, he's brought me back into the path of righteousness. Listen, I'm not going to be before you long, but is there anybody in here who has walked off the path because you tried to do it your way? Is there anybody that can testify to me this morning that can say, listen, I tried to do it my way, and every time I tried to do it my way, it messed me up. But the moment I surrendered to God and said, God, have your will in my life. God, you take control of where I'm headed, and God has led you even through the valley of the shadow of death. He brought you out on the mountaintop for you to be able to testify. If it had not been for the Lord who was leading, guiding, and directing me, I would be a lost soul right about now. But I think I've got 3 or 4 folk, and I'll make 5 in this house, that can testify, God, I'm so glad that I'm holding to your unchanging hand. And even if I've got scratches and bruises, even if I've got to bandage myself up, I'm coming through this because on the other side of through, the best is still yet to come. My brothers and sisters, here the translation of what Solomon is writing is that no matter how accomplished you may be, I don't care how much experience you may have, I don't care how many birthdays you've celebrated, you need God. Would you turn to the person next to you? Don't touch them. Just look at them and say, I need God. You said it like you're Catholic. I want to find some good Baptist folk who can testify. Listen, if God didn't keep me last night, I couldn't have kept myself in my own right mind. So I need you to turn to somebody, and even if you got to get a ghetto neck roll and say, I need God. Yeah. I need him. I need him every hour. Every time I turn around, I need God. Every time I go to work on Monday through Friday, I need God. Every time I've got to deal with Black folks' attitudes and got to deal with their proclivities. I need God. Sometimes when I come to church, I need God to be with me because I don't know who's going to show up. But as long as my mind is stayed on God, he's going to keep me in perfect peace. Do I have anybody here who can just shout out, I need God? Time I go to the doctor's office, they seem to find something, but since I've got God, he's able to take what doctors are concerned and make it a celebration right there in the waiting room. Anybody in here who just had praise and worship there in the doctor's office, in your boss's office, you just said, God, I need you, because if you don't keep me, I will kill somebody. Y'all sit down. I got one more block to run. I got you. You need God. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 5 and 7 that we walk by faith, not by sight. The eyes are the sensory organ that allows us to see. The eyes capture visible light around you and turns it into a form your brain uses to create the sense of vision. Because the brain does not have its own sensory ability on its own. The brain only reacts to what your other senses do. So your brain is able to tell you somebody's cleaning chitlins when you smell it. Look how some of you frowned up. Your brain tells you that pot is hot because you touched it. That brain tells you after you've smelled something that's not so wonderful, that it stinks. Your brain reacts to what goes onto your palate in your mouth and tells you what it is. And so your brain cannot operate separate from your senses. Woo! And I've come to let you know, ladies and gentlemen, that neither can the body of Christ. We are all sensory organs that says to the brain of God how much we love him. See, that's why you can't come to church with your mouth closed. Because God doesn't know you appreciate what he's done for you. I wish I had a half a church. See, some folk, God has brought you through this week and you've gone through hell and high water and you've come in here like you're sitting in the library. Let me tell you, ladies, you're in the sanctuary and not the cemetery. And that ought to be enough for you to say, God, I thank you. You can't keep my mouth shut with all the stuff he's brought me through. You mean to tell me you're going to sit stoic and you're going to sit like a mannequin after God has brought you over danger after danger, and you come here because you don't want your neighbor to get upset with you? Just tell him SOS, scoot over some, because I've got to praise and I've got to get this thing. You don't know what it took for me to get here this Sunday morning, and since I've got the sensory gland to be able to raise my hand, since I've got the ability to think about what God has done for me, since I've got the ability to remember the danger that he's brought me over, I'm not going to sit here and keep my mouth closed, my hands to my side. I'm not going to sit here and not act like I'm ready to run track in this place, but I'm going to give God the best praise I can. I'm done. It's the sensory organs that trigger the brain. And so, since this morning we're dealing with the eye exam, David wrote in Psalms 121, the Song of Degrees. He said, in displaying his trust in God's protection and guidance, he says this: I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills from whence cometh my help. Can I preach for just two more minutes? I'm out of your way. That's two. I'm going to lift up mine eyes to the hills from whence cometh my help. For my help cometh from the Lord, the same one that made the heavens and the earth and everything that's in it. So David realized that his eyes needed to be fixed on God. As I head to my seat, Redeeming Love, I just want to remind you, take your eyes off of what you see. And I want you to see what you believe. Because sometimes what you see can be deceptive. Sometimes if you get caught up on CNN and MSNBC, you will become discouraged. But instead of watching CNN, I want you to watch G-O-D and watch him move in your life. I got to leave you, Redeeming Love. But in our text, in our scripture this morning, if it sounds familiar, it is. Because Isaiah wrote in Isaiah 64:4, for since the beginning of the world, men have not heard nor perceived by ear, neither have they seen with their eye. O God, beside thee, what he hath prepared for him that waiteth for him. It is also the same prophet, the eagle-eyed prophet, that wrote in Psalms 40:28. He said something like this, that you shall live and declare the works of the Lord. My brothers and sisters, we can be deceived in life by some things that we see. We can make life-changing decisions by what we see or perceived based on what you've either heard or seen. There are times, ladies and gentlemen, when you can't believe everything that you see. How many of us have heard our parents say something like this? I don't believe what I'm seeing, because they knew they taught you a whole lot better than what you're acting like. We often heard that when we were out of their purview and we were trying to be something when we were not. And Paul is now saying to the church of Corinth, I really don't believe what I'm seeing because I've taught you better than this. When I established this church, it was for you to hear the word of God so that it would become a part of your life. But I think I have a few folk who can testify that your mama didn't throw you out with the water. She just corrected you and brought you back in to the teachings that she had imparted in you. And so here it is, my brothers and sisters. Paul is telling the church at Corinth, I don't care how gifted you are, you've got to watch where you are around you, because the enemy comes to steal, kill, and destroy. But God came to protect the gift that he's got inside of you. Come on, Tonto, let's get ready to ride. The Bible says that now that Paul has been coming to Corinth and he's established this church, he wants them to understand that the important part of seeing God with your spiritual eye and not your natural eye is reliant upon your faith. When you see, ladies and gentlemen, you see the handiwork of what God has done. But for those who are visually impaired, they still see in a different way. Maybe they can't see the print on the pages, but they have Braille that they can still be able to read the same thing you do. Maybe they can't see the curb that's in front of them, but they do have an apparatus or a seeing eye dog that can lead them to the same place you've gone without harming themselves. And so with faith, you can't see see God moving, but you've got to have enough faith to know that God is moving. You don't believe me? You had faith when you went into bed last night that God would wake you up this morning. And I just stopped by to tell somebody here at 3425, if Paul could write about seeing and he knew how folk looked at him, but the best was still yet to come out of the persecutor called Saul. And I just want you to know that if Paul could write in 1 Corinthians, the 2nd chapter, verse number 9, that I have not seen, neither ear heard, what God is about to do in me, not because I deserve it, but because I love him, I got to leave your redeeming love. I ain't got nothing else on my page, but I think I better tell you that as I leave this pulpit, that God is not through with you yet. You may feel like you're between a rock and a hard place, but I just want you to know that the best is still yet to come. Is there anybody here at Redeeming Love who can testify, this time last year I thought I was going to lose my mind. This time 2 years ago when COVID was rampant, I thought I wasn't going to make it, but still God had his hand upon my life, and today I'm better, I'm stronger, I'm wiser than I was last year. Is there anybody in here who can testify I'm here not because of my good doing, but by the grace of God I'm still standing? Shout yeah, say yeah, put those hands together and give God praise. Listen, you might as well keep standing because I'm almost done. The best is still yet to come. The Bible said that there was a time when folk who saw Jesus, they only saw him as Joseph's stepson, Mary's little baby. But I'm so glad that on this day that we commemorate as Palm Sunday, he came riding into Jerusalem on a borrowed donkey, and folk had not seen him, but the best, wish I had it, the best was yet to come. He rode in and they screamed, Hosanna in the highest. Somebody lift up your voice and shout hallelujah. He came riding, and folk who had not seen him screamed out in anticipation, the best. Say yeah, say yeah, say, 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 say yeah. And look, come, Emery, come get it. I'm done. What's that? Four? Okay. I got one more close. So you understand this text. Paul, who was the last apostle to be selected was criticized by folk who knew him. Church don't know when to shout. Two-thirds of the New Testament, Bob, was written by the last person in. Okay, so you forgot the scripture that said, the first shall be last. And the last shall be first. So while Paul is writing to the church at Corinth, Bob, here's what he does. He's speaking to the church, but he's really speaking to you. Okay, you missed it. Let me come get you. He does not say church at Corinth, even though the letter is written to the Corinthians. He just says, as it is written, not just for Corinth, but for Mark, for Nancy, for Brian, for Christy, for Riri. Watch this. He says, I haven't seen. Nor ear heard the great things that God, all right? See, they've been watching what your job has done for you. They've been watching what your boo or your bae has done for you. But it pales in comparison to what God is about to do. Can I tell you, you may not have money, but God's about to bless you anyway. You may not have education, but God's going to give you favor. You may not have a 5-bedroom house, but God's about to. Say yeah! Instead of trying to get even, just tell your haters, all eyes on me, because the best. Stand on your feet. I'm just building to next Sunday. Because see, this Sunday, he wrote in, and folk who had not seen him were celebrating him. Because the best was riding into town. Oh, but you come back. Stay tuned. Another bad channel, another bad episode is coming your way next week. Because you're going to see how the best is still yet to come. They celebrated him today, but by Friday, I don't know who I'm talking to. They, listen, before y'all broke from work this past Friday, they was loving you. But by this coming Friday, woo! I just came to encourage somebody this morning. Your right now is temporary, but the best is still yet to come. They see you now, but God sees you in the future. And you got to hold to God's unchanging hand that he's never going to leave you nor forsake you. This morning, I want to talk to some folk. You believe this is all there is for you, where you are right now. You're going through a stage of temporary adjustment for a permanent change. Those of us that are here and have been walking with Christ for a number of years will tell you, this road does not get easy. As a matter of fact, if I can be honest, it's harder now than it was then. It's much more complex. Because when I was in the street, I knew how to treat folk that treated me wrong. Come on, Andre, you can help me. I appreciate you, man. Thank you. Appreciate you. All the rest of y'all too sanctified and Holy Ghost filled. I get that. But I knew how I would react to somebody who did something to me. But now, in this walk, he asked me to bless those who curse me. Do good unto those who done evil to me. Speak kindly for those who've had my name in their mouth since they encountered me. God, you asking me to do too much until I realize how I treated him and he still loved me. If you're here today and it seems like there's no end to the tribulation, the trauma, and the drama in your life, let me just share with you the best is still yet to come for you. I know you don't see it. I know it doesn't even feel like it. But the Lord has laid on my heart through this message to say to you, the best is still yet to come. Oh, thank. If you're here today and you don't know who Jesus Christ is, I want to say to you, the best is still yet to come. All you need to do, you can shake my hand, but I want you to give your heart to Jesus Christ. This morning, your best is right around the corner. You just got to learn how to hold on. If that's you, I want you to make your way right here. Listen, if you don't want to walk alone, just raise your hand. I've got deacons in the aisles right now. I'll come down and I'll walk with you. But if you don't know who Christ is, you will never experience that best that we've talked about this morning. Well, listen, Pastor, I know who Christ is. I just don't have a church home. I've been looking, I've been searching, and the Lord is speaking to my heart this morning to say, this is where I need to be. If that's you, won't you come right now? You can raise your hand. One of our redeeming partners or our deacons in the aisle, they'll walk with you to come down so you won't have to feel alone. Listen, Pastor, I know who Christ is. I have a church home, but I'm just simply not growing where I'm going. If the Lord is speaking to you to transplant you into this field, into this vineyard called Redeeming Love, I want you to step out on faith right now. Ooh, you've been so good. I just listen, if you walked away from Redeeming Love and you're ready to come back home, come on right now, wherever you are in this sanctuary, come on right now. Don't let this moment pass you by. Don't allow this worship experience and encounter fall to the ground, but let it germinate in your spirit and say, the best is still yet to come for me. Do me a favor, ask the person next to you, do you need me to walk with you? Do you need me to walk with you? Come on, do you need me to walk? Don't look at me, ask the person next to you. Ask a visitor, say, do you need me to walk with you? I'm glad to walk with you. If you're here today, come on right now. If they start stumbling, I bring them down anyway. Bring them down anyway. Come on. If you're in this house today, I want the best for you, and it is still yet to come. Come on right now. Thank you, Lord. Come on right now. Listen, if you want to be prayed for, you're facing something this coming week, I want you to come down right now. Let these deacons, let these preachers pray for you. I just want to. You've been so good. So good. Yes, you have. You've been so good. Yes, you've been so thank you, Lord. Thank you. I just want to. Listen. This morning, while our deacons and preachers are praying for these individuals and families that are here at the altar, this morning we want to corporately pray for the Thomas family. And we're praying for them because of what occurred with Sister Sharon. And now it's in the hands of the judicial system. And so now we are asking you that even as Deacon Emery Dobbin is going to pray, that you point your hand down this way towards the Thomas family. That justice will be served.
Our Father and our God, we come at this appointed hour, O God, standing in the need of prayer. And God, as we come before you right now, we first ask, oh God, that you will forgive us. Anything that we have done, oh God, that is not pleasing in your sight, oh God, forgive us now and create within us a new and a right spirit. And oh God, we stand at this altar, and we cast our cares upon you, the author and finisher of our faith, O God. God, we realize that without you walking with us and you talking with us, O God, and you being our covering, where would we be? And on this Sunday morning, we give you all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise, O God. God, because you went to a hill, hung on a cross, and died that we may have the right to live a loving, fulfilling life in you. And we realize, oh God, that this earth has things, but in you we have everlasting joy.
We have peace beyond measure. We have healing. And God, if we give it all unto you, that you would walk us through moment by moment, step by step, oh God. And we stand in agreement with our brothers and sisters here at this altar right now, that whatever they stand in need of, oh God, God, that you would grant it to them right now. If it's strength, oh God, strengthen them where they're weak. If it's healing in their body, oh God, touch them only as you can. If it's comfort, oh God, let your grace and mercy encamp around them right now, oh God. Whatever they stand in need of, we know you to be a healer, a way maker. And oh God, we cast our cares upon you. And oh God, as we stand in this corporate prayer, we ask, oh God, that you touch the family of Sister Sharon Thomas right now, oh God. God, heal their hearts. Touch their minds. And let them know, oh God, that you're with them. There is man's justice, but God, we're depending on your justice right now. Heal that sorrowful heart, oh God. Encourage them and let them know, God, everything is going to be all right. God, we just thank you now for it is already done. We're naming it and claiming it, oh God. And we just bless your holy name. And oh God, as we depart from this place and we reflect on this week of what you did on that cross, there's not enough words, there's not enough praise to say thank you for all that you are in our lives. But God, we give you the glory and the honor that you justly do. And we'll forever give your name the praise that you are so deservedly need. It is in Jesus' name that we do pray. And let us all say amen.
Listen, ladies and gentlemen, as we enter into Holy Week, I want you to be mindful of what he did for you and for me. And this week, I want you to take time to pray in thanksgiving of what was already done. I want you to take this week to be reflective of how he sacrificed his very life for you and for me. Don't forget Wednesday night Bible study on Zoom. Don't forget Thursday morning man of prayer, and Friday, I want this church congregation to come out. This ain't your regular Friday night. Okay? Don't make plans to go to the movies. Make plans to come to the seven last statements. Because he hung on the cross for you. Okay? Capitol Grill can wait till next week. But come and be a part of these seven last statements. And let us bless God. Amen. All minds and hearts clear. Birthdays. That's it. You had a birthday the month of March, right? Happy birthday to you. Those of you who were celebrating birthdays in March, let me see your hands. Wave them in the air. Wave them like you just done. Okay, I'm sorry. Woo! Listen, we've got cupcakes, or if you have an anniversary in March. Who had an anniversary in March? Listen, join us in the fellowship hall for some cupcakes and some treats. Everybody's invited. I want our birthday and also our anniversary celebrants to go first and partake of that as well. All right? Go Duke tonight. Amen. Father. All right. And now may the grace of God, the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit, allow it to rest, rule, and abide henceforth, now, and forevermore. Let us all say amen. Say amen one more time.